Good evening. I'm Florian Becker. I teach here, and I would like to welcome you all, students, of course, here to this event. And especially, I'd like to welcome people from the neighborhood who we have a little sort of student helper, helped, aided scheme where we swarmed out and we tried to put actual paper invitation. We'd kind of forgotten that paper invitation still exists, because who still deals with paper invitations, to this event and to other events that we have going here in the next few weeks into people's mailboxes, in order to just signal what we, of course, were hoping would be known anyways, namely that our events are all free and they're all open to the public. And since this neighborhood is changing quite rapidly, it all looks the same, it looks like it's never changing, but actually a lot of people are moving in, and there's an increased international presence, we thought that the fact that our events are all in English will no longer be a hindrance to a lot of people perhaps wanting to come. So welcome to all of those of you who are from the neighborhood, and perhaps it's your first time here, but I hope it won't be your last time. But all of this responsibility rests on Norman Manea's shoulders.
Absolutely.
I'm very pleased to welcome Norman Manea back here to Bard College Berlin. The last time he visited Bard College Berlin was called Eklat of Bard. Eklat is the European College of Liberal Arts, which is still very much in our DNA. I would just like to say a few very brief words about Norman Manea. I'm sure that many of you know everything that I'm going to tell you, but nevertheless. Norman Manea was born in the Bukovina, which is a region of Romania that is known to very many literate Germans because of the rich cultural and especially literary heritage, not only obviously in the German language, but also in Romanian, and even in Yiddish and other languages. He was born, if I may be so indiscreet as to mention it, in 1936. At the age of five, he was deported to a camp in Transnistria, where he spent his childhood, essentially, survived, finished his schooling, secondary schooling, got a engineering degree, master's degree, something to do with hydropower in Bucharest. And by the time that he was forced into exile, some years later, at the age of 50, 49, something like that. First to Germany, actually, on a DAD in West Berlin, and then on to the United States. By that time, he was already very well known, not just in Romania, as a writer, as the author of many volumes of fiction and non-fiction, the apprenticeship years of Augustus the Fool, October 8 O'Clock, the marvelous story collection, and many others. And while Norman Manea's fiction since 1986, since Exile, has often analyzed that condition and the condition of being a refugee in ways that, you know, obviously serious, but also often with considerable humor, the difficulties of life as a refugee never managed to stifle his imagination somehow. I'm sure it wasn't always pleasant, but it didn't manage to do that, and certainly the productivity has remained quite astounding since then. I'll just mention two of his works since 1986, the On Clowns, The Dictator and the Artist, and Hooligan's Return, which I brought with me in English translation because of the beautiful cover image. It has the same, the German version has the same image. I'm sure you had something to do with that. When Norman visited us here in 2000, 12. The occasion was the launch of the German translation of The Lair, Die Höhle, another novel that is quite serious, but also quite, I guess I'm allowed to say funny, right? It has a certain,
You take the responsibility.
I take the responsibility. And this year he's again in Berlin as a guest of the Literatur Festival that all of you probably know is going on right now. This time on the heels of the publication of the German title is Wir sind alle im Exil, essentially a selection of pieces from the Fifth Impossibility essays on exile and language. I've seen it in many bookshops around Berlin. I was telling Norman, and he said, yes, he'd already sold 29 million copies. Yes. He is the recipient of many honors, as many of you may know, the Guggenheim Fellowship, the MacArthur Fellowship, the Nonino Prize in Italy, the Prix Medici in Etranger, the Nelly Sachs Prize here in Germany, the National Prize for Literature of the Romanian Writers Union, and the Palau di Fabre Essay Prize in Spain. He's a fellow of the Akademie der Künste here in Berlin, also a fellow of the Royal Society of Literature, a member of the French Legion of Honor, Legion d'Honneur, and a commander of the Romanian Order of Cultural Merit. I mentioned just a few of the honors, because I know that writers pretend that they don't mean anything, but I've heard many conversations, not by Norman, but of writers where they were comparing prizes and honors to each other, so it doesn't matter. Maybe. So please join me in welcoming Norman Manea back to the college. And before you applaud, I hope, to welcome him, I also want to introduce briefly two of our students who, those of you who don't study or work here, probably don't know, Inasa Vidic and David Kretz, who are going to, be responsible, Norman, for the rest of this evening. So you have some other shoulders to share this burden. Thank you very much for coming again.
I would like to welcome everyone once again, and a special welcome to Norman Manea for joining us tonight. And how we see tonight is in form of a conversation, so we wish to talk with the audience and really see how we understand his writings from the readings that will be presented to us by three of our students: Ola, a second-year student, and two first-year students, Alex and Cody. And after the readings, we, David and I, will ask Norman a few questions. After that, it's all up to the audience. You're free to ask whatever you want to Norman or either of us. So it's open-ended. It's this night is for all of us.
Should we just start?
The first excerpt we'll be reading is from Moments of Shame.
Modernity has accelerated, more than any other human epoch, history's centrifugal dynamics. Yet even modernity, perhaps more than the traditional past, left the individual alone, robbed of any other center than his own self. This clouded, convoluted, and pulsating self has proved to be insufficient and frustrating for too many people. Does anyone seriously believe that mankind is prepared to renounce the great enterprise of crime and killing? A deep skepticism, if not bitterness and despair, seems unavoidable. Some 10 years ago, I proposed something very much non-utopian, and I would like to revisit that proposal today. It was in an intervention I made in the famous Valsa debate of 1998 in Germany. As some of you may recall, the esteemed German writer Martin Valsa, in his acceptance speech on receiving the Peace Prize of the German Booksellers Association at the Frankfurt Book Fair, warned against the permanent representation and the monumentalizing of German shame. My response was to suggest that every country, and I emphasize again, every country, and every people, should complement its monuments of heroism with monuments of shame. This would mean recalling a nation's wrongdoings towards other countries, other people, and also to its own people. To love our neighbors as ourselves may imply scrutinizing ourselves with the same objectivity as our neighbor, and not doing to others what we don't like to suffer ourselves. It is probably good therapy to look at ourselves with the same exigency as we look at others, to put ourselves in the shoes of others in order to understand their otherness. Aren't modesty and humility and self-questioning a desirable and sound exercise for being truly human? But if we really want to return to a more hopeful perspective, we need to return to the individual, the frail, sinful, and heroic conqueror of nature and sometimes of his own nature, to his rich and resourceful imperfection, to his struggle to be more than he succeeded to be, to find a meaning in his often meaningless environment, to be a creator who adds to what is already spread around him. Despite the great scientific and technical achievements of modernity, despite prosperity and the visible improvements in human rights, the loneliness and estrangement of the individual has not disappeared. Indeed, the opposite is true.
The second excerpt will be read from the collection of essays, The Fifth Impossibility, and particularly The Fifth Impossibility, the essay.
The first impossibility to which Kafka refers is the impossibility of not writing. I could have built the pyramids with the effort needed to keep me alive and to keep me rational, he wrote to Felice Bauer on April 13, 1913. We understand what it means to keep alive. He himself admits it in another letter to Felice just a week later. I am awake only among my imaginary characters, April 20th, 1913. He'll repeat it in his August 14th epistle. I do not have literary interests. I am made of literature. I am nothing else and I cannot be anything else. He repeats it even more drastically in a letter to Felice's father of August 28th, 1913. My entire being is bent towards literature. For Kafka, this is what it means to keep alive. My entire existence is bent towards literature. The second I abandon it, I cease living. Everything I am, and am not, is a consequence of this. Kafka formulates the second impossibility as the impossibility of writing in German. He sees a tragic estrangement and a vulgar usurpation in the use of the German language, openly present or masked, or perhaps a self-tormented usurpation of a foreign property which remains in the possession of another, even if not one linguistic mistake can be pointed out. The estrangement appears as a consequence of the ambiguity of another, a fissured, hunted being in search of a coming into possession which would legitimize and justify it. Kafka seems to consider the acquisition and the use of the German language as a betrayal of identity, even as an act of piracy, imagined as the snatching of a foreign babe from its cradle and one's abusive acquisition of it. The third impossibility in which the Jewish German writer is confronted while trying to follow his inspiration, meaning his despair, is the impossibility of writing differently. Does differently mean in another language? To the three assumed negations, Kafka adds a fourth, namely the impossibility of writing, pure and simple, since despair was not something that could be tamed by writing. It seems surprising that Franz Kafka did not mention his fifth impossibility, the most Kafka-esque of all, though he thought about it more than once. I am here at the General Society of Insurance, and still I hope to be in faraway countries, at a window above sugarcane plantations, or looking out towards Muslim cemeteries. The exile of his family, of love and profession, the exile par excellence, anytime and anywhere, did not necessarily have to meditate on the hypothesis of expatriation. We see this hypothesis in the Hunter Grappus, in Jackals and Arabs, or in a shorter text like The Wish to be a Red Indian, which one should cite in full. If one were only an Indian, instantly alert and on a racing horse, leaning against the wind, kept on quivering jerkily over the quivering ground until one shed one's spurs, for there needed no spurs, threw away the reins, for there needed no reins, and hardly saw that the land before was smoothly shorn heath when horse's neck and head would already be gone. We see it also in the Great Wall of China as an opposition, but also as an unfinished and unfinishable preparation for a new Tower of Babel. A horizontally sprawling construction, a solid, infinite foundation which the collapsed tower never had, having been in too great a hurry to reach the heights. built to protect against an enemy that no one had ever seen, but which was thought to be human, certainly not divine. The wall, in fact, defends the authority. The construction of portions, whose meeting point is unknown, is at last divided into parcels and given to each individual citizen, who in turn comes to be identified with his or her parcel, whose existence is occupied and symbolized by a portion of the wall. The force of the edifice is based on the weakness of each of its builders, all of whom are incapable of overthrowing the authority, which resides in the enigmatic and far-off center, by pulling this authority towards them and so undoing it. The weakness fulfills the unity of people and is the earth on which this population lives. Its condemnation would mean the shattering not only of conscience, but even worse, the earth under one's feet. The text of a hallucinatory precision and stylistic oddity, perfectly adequate for a report, scrutinizes the illusion of total and totalitarian coherence, the never-reached fulfillment of the utopian project. Like itself, it's home to estrangement and indifference, meaning exile, consumed in ephemeral portions of destiny without destiny. One could name exile the fifth impossibility, fulfilling an interrogatory function for all other impossibilities as the impossibility of the operetta, to borrow E.M. Schorian's words, according to whom it is better to write operettas than to write in a foreign language. Perhaps it would also be suggested to name it the impossibility of the snail, meaning the impossibility of continuing to write in exile, even when the writer takes his language with him. The shell allows a refuge anywhere the snail may happen to go, but how utterly endangered it is through its relocation. The life of its inhabitant is glimpsed as soon as he imprudently raises his antennae unprepared for the new earth, new sky, and new creatures, or for the appealing or hostile sounds of their languages. The shipwreck of the snail in the torrid and tormented desert of the dynamic modern Babel more than once destroys his chances of survival. Such an extreme situation seems drawn from the Kafkaesque premise itself, and our forerunner K could not be unattracted by such an extravagant hypothesis of self-destruction. Meaning, salvation through self-destruction. The idea that Tibet is far away from Vienna seems so silly to me, Kafka writes to Milano. I am reading a book about Tibet, at a description of a settlement close to the Tibetan frontier, in the mountains. My heart grows suddenly heavy. This village seems so empty, so far away from Vienna. That which I call silly is the idea that Tibet is so far away from Vienna. Is it really so far? He asks her, asking himself, knowing all too well that the emptiness is not really far off at all, but dangerously close to Vienna, to Prague, to the house of his family, to the general society of insurance, to the room of his solitude. The sugarcane plantations had not really been far off either, nor the Islamic cemeteries, nor the Great Wall. It is not necessary to imagine Kafka in Saudi Arabia, or in communist China, or in Brazil, where the very un-Kafka-esque Viennese Jew, Stefan Zweig, would later, in exile, kill himself in Kafka, in order to authenticate one of the most expressive and most frequent Kafkaesque situations of the new millennium, hurrying to shatter memories and hopes. Similarly, it is not necessary to imagine Kafka in the New York of his protagonist Karl Rossmann, in the city of exiles par excellence, or to imagine him nearby in New York, in the room in the house of an elderly Jewish lady on the shabby lower stretch of Avon Avenue, as in Looking at Kafka by Philip Roth. In any case, in the nocturnal room of his Prague exile, Kafka had been in these and in many other places far away and nowhere at all. Like many of Kafka's other premonitions, this impossibility, unstated, but nevertheless lived and expressed with the same anxiety and force, would surprisingly go on to fertilize the topoi of contemporary reality. Kafka's posterity has extended the condition of the Jew to many other categories of exiles, however, without nullifying the Jewish impossibility. Primo Levi said, saved himself at Auschwitz through the German language. After the Holocaust, Paul Celan continued to cite Adorno's warning to write not only poems, but poetry in the language of his mother's butchers. To the end, the homeland of Mandelstam remained the Russian language, the language in which Stalin had signed his death warrant. The generalized exile of postmodern global society has extended possibilities while trivializing the impossibilities of the exile text, and all in a period which euphemistically calls its deviations and incoherence mobility. Joyce Musil and Thomas Mann, Konrad and Nabokov, Gombrowicz and Bacheva Singer, Beckett and Ionescu, Brodsky, Cortazar, and Danilo Kish have conferred a new legitimacy on expatriation, along with everything that the keeping or abandoning of the maternal language in exile means. They are the forerunners of a world of vast interferences in which we live. It is difficult to imagine Kafka in the new world of today, and even more difficult to see him in the clownish role of telegenic prompter of his own works, as the computerized entertainment corporation of the planetary circus demands. The manner in which the solitary Franz Kafka surpassed the impossibilities he faced without truly surpassing them, surviving in the German language of his estrangement, reminds our memoryless epic of the hope without hope contained in his unrepeatable model. If, in our fight against the world, we must, in the end, take the part of the world against ourselves, as Kafka advised us to do, the lay prayer of writing remains a last refuge for refusal, as well as for resignation. After all, the suspect who prays through writing doesn't only exist as a mythic creation of profane letters spinning around the anagramic mystery of the world, still seeking his place in the repertoire of curiosities so many derisory homelands, but is real in his exile, and in his exiled reality embodies all of the impossibilities of his existence.
And the third and the last selection we'll be reading is the essay, The Exiled Language, also from the Fifth Impossibility.
In the beginning was the word, the agents told us. In the beginning for me, the word was Romanian. The doctor and all those who assisted at my difficult birth spoke Romanian. Romanian was spoken in my home, where I spent most of my time with Maria, the lovely young peasant woman who took care of me and spoiled me, in Romanian. Of course, these were not the only sounds around me. German, Yiddish, Ukrainian, and Polish were spoken in Bukovina, as was a peculiar dialect, a Slavic mixture typical of the Ruthenians. It is notable that the family quarrel between Yiddish, the earthly plebeian language of exile, and Hebrew, the holy chosen language, peaked at the 1908 Chernovitz Conference, when the celebrated triumph of Yiddish, the Jews are one people, their language is Yiddish, gave no sign of the spectacular and definitive domination that Hebrew would attain with the founding 4 decades later of the State of Israel. When my grandfather asked at my birth if the newborn had nails, trying to gauge my chances of survival, he presumably asked in Yiddish, although he knew Hebrew and spoke fluent Romanian. The books sold in his bookshop were, in fact, Romanian. At 5, when I was deported to the Transnistria concentration camp, along with the rest of Bukovina's Jewish population, I spoke only Romanian. With my first expulsion beyond the Dniester, the Romanian language was also banished. The Yiddish poet Itzhak Manger once said, "When the great calamity overwhelmed the German assimilated Jew, when a brutal sergeant major roared, 'Out, Jew!' the German Jew woke from his self-justifying dream, from his trance of German culture, and began to run. But in himself and with himself, he carried a bastard, a foreign language, a foreign body." In my case, a brutal Romanian, not German, the sergeant major roared, "Out, Jew!" But the Romanian language I carried wasn't a bastard or a foreign body, it was my only language. It was also, of course, the language of that brutal sergeant major, and this I was already aware of at too early an age. In the camp, I learned Yiddish from the elderly captives and Ukrainian from native children in the neighborhood. After liberation by the Red Army, I attended a Russian school for 1 year. When we returned to Romania in 1945, I enrolled in a Romanian school, but my parents soon arranged for me to be privately tutored in German. What we experienced during those years of terror in Transnistria had originated, they knew quite well, in Hitler's Berlin. But they were also aware of, even though they were not particularly well educated in, the difference between recent horror and the longer view between hatred and culture. I studied Hebrew for only 1 year, when I was roughly 13, in order to be formally accepted among the men of the tribe. Surprisingly, traces resurface even today when I least expect them. In high school, I learned French and Russian, but none of the languages I had taken up ever became fully internalized. Echoes of my subconscious cosmopolitanism sound only occasionally these days when, suddenly, and without effort on my part, the proper turn of phrase occurs to me in a conversation held in one of those half-familiar, still foreign languages, even when I have access to them. In the end, I feel at home in only one language. Writing seems a childish pursuit, as we well know, even when done with the excessive seriousness to which children are prone. My long road to this immaturity began one July day in 1945, several months after our return from the camps, an Edenic summer in a small Moldavian town. The enchanted banality of the normal, the overwhelming joy of finally feeling secure. A perfect afternoon, sun and stillness. In the room's half light, I listened to a voice that was mine and yet not my own. The green book of Romanian folktales I had been given just before I reached the solemn age of 9 spoke directly to me. It was then, I think, that I experienced the wonder of the word, the magic of literature, both wound and balm, disease and therapy. The language to which I had been subjected in the Transnistria camps was a cacophony that mingled despair with barked orders from the guards. That brutal sergeant major roaring, Yiddish, German, Ukrainian, Russian, all the camp's idioms rushed into the chasm it had rent in my life. I left the socialist penal colony much too late, because I was childish enough to believe that I did not live in a country, but in a language. Liberation, I knew, entailed a malignant curtailing of freedom itself. In December 1986, I boarded a flight to Berlin, knowing full well that I might have traded my tongue for a passport. But I didn't feel, even in this extreme situation, that my language was the usurpation of an alien property, as Kafka thought. It was, in fact, my only property, and the willingness to accept this loss speaks volumes about the flaming brothel, as Sharon called the region he himself left behind, not suspecting the horrors the socialist combination of brothel, circus, and prison would bring. For the writer, language is a placenta. Language is not only a sweet and glorious conquest, but legitimization, a home. Being driven out of this essential lair, his creativity is burned to the core. My second exile, this time at the age of 50 instead of 5, gave expropriation and delegitimization new meaning. The honor of being expelled was inseparable from being silenced as a writer. Nonetheless, I did take my nomadic language with me, like a snail its house. During a stay at the Liebig House, writer's colony in Switzerland some years ago, I asked a renowned German translator of Russian what age one had to start learning another language well enough to become a writer in it. Nabokov had learned foreign languages as a child. Conrad had sailed between ports and languages when still young enough to adapt. I knew that the usual examples did not fit. 12, the expert announced. Too bad, I said. I'm already 13. By then, I had more than doubled the double of that age. Yet the uprooting and dispossession of exile are a trauma with some positive aspects. They only become apparent once one understands the advantage of relinquishing the idea of one's own importance. Hyperminence and insecurity can be liberating. Exile is also a challenging pedagogical experience. There is much to learn when one is forced to begin again at an advanced age, to enter into the world anew and prove one's abilities again, like an old child whose past has been wiped out but who has been offered a second chance, to rebuild his life from scratch, even if without one's former energy and vigor. At the age of 26, the Romanian writer E.M. Charon began appropriating the wealth of the French language like a greedy pirate. He called this metamorphosis of linguistic identity the greatest, most dramatic event that can befall a writer. Historical catastrophes are nothing compared to this, he later claimed. When I wrote in Romanian, words were not independent of me. As soon as I began to write in French, I consciously chose each word. I had them before me, outside of me, each in its place, and I chose them. Now I'll take you, then you. The break to which Chiron had aspired in leaving Romania was more than linguistic. When I changed my language, I annihilated my past. I changed my entire life. Is this true? As a famous French author and brilliant stylist in his adopted language, Chiron was constantly haunted by ghosts of the past, which he found oppressive and humiliating. My country! I wanted to hang on to it at any cost, but there was nothing to hang on, he wrote in the 1950s. Chiron's glorious linguistic transmutation, however, was not completely triumphant after all. Today again, it seems that I am writing in a language that does not fit me at all, that has no roots, a hothouse language. French does not suit any temperament. I need a savage, drunken language, he told Fernando Savitar in 1977. On his deathbed, he rediscovered Romanian, but not himself. He experienced the ecstasy of Alzheimer's amnesia, the greatest joy, the highest penalty, the end. My reasons for severing my ties were perhaps stronger than Chiron's, but still I hung on to my native tongue. And since I cannot turn back the clock, I cannot aspire to the transfiguration and profound radical change toward which Chiron struggled during his decades in exile. Ultimately, the question concerning writers is related not only to their linguistic identity, but also to their individual drive and destiny. Compared to collective historical disasters, their worries seem childish. Many artists and writers collapse in exile or at home before the problem of a change in their linguistic identity arises. And yet, historical catastrophes may pale beside the dark forces that destroy their language. I was almost completely at sea in English. To my fright, I found myself to be like Nabokov's Professor Panin, who thought Hamlet sounded better in his native Russian than in English. In my first decade here, I became terribly anxious when invited to speak at conferences, not only because of my accent, but also because I constantly feared I would lose or forget my script. I still remember arriving in Turin in 1991 and finding that my bags were missing. I was to give my lecture in English the next morning, and in despair, I tried to convince the conference's organizers to move to the afternoon. In the meantime, my suitcases arrived and my luck increased. Several Italian-Romanian interpreters were attending so that I could speak off the cuff. This epilogue was much happier than a story of the poor Pnin, who misses his train to the conference and even brings the wrong lecture. In one of the dreams Antonio Tabucci describes in his picturesque novel, Requiem of Hallucination, a dream expedition in search of Fernando Pessoa, the narrator meets his dead father. The father is young and surprisingly does not speak Italian, the only language he knew, but Portuguese. Is that because the hallucination takes place in Portugal, or because the Italian writer did not write his book in his native tongue, but in the second language, Portuguese? What are you doing in a sailor's uniform here in the pension pensão? The son asks. It's 1932, the father answers. I'm doing my military service. Then our ship, a frigate, dropped anchor in Lisbon. He wants to know from his son, who is older than he and knows more, how he will die. The son tells his father of the cancer, which has, in reality, already killed him. Not only in the beginning was the word. Before the final silence, we often end our existence with the word. Chekhov spoke his last words, Ich sterbe, I'm dying. Not in the language of his life and works, but in that of the land where he ended his earthly adventure. In the rare times in which I see my parents, they speak Romanian. And yet I cannot foresee in which language I will take my leave of this world. Death's language sometimes differs from that of the life to which it is putting an end.
To our readers. It's interesting how differently people read things. I think we had very vigorous readings. When I read it earlier, I felt very much, the text felt slower. But I think that's great to have readings and to compare how it feels at different speeds. Thanks very much for these excerpts and for being here. I am very interested in a phenomenon that you touched on briefly in these texts, which is the phenomenon of translation. And you have been widely translated, but I'm not just about being translated, but also as it sheds light on some of the questions that you raise with the text. So let me try to explain that a bit. You give, I think, the 2 points in the text, this image of the writer as a snail, the writer in exile, as a snail who is carrying his or her house, his language with them as a house, the culture, and who lead a very fragile, barely mobile existence that is humbling. But at the same time, you also describe these individuals as heroic and struggling, creators of meaning. And I'm curious, or would like to invite you to compare, consider perhaps the translator as a figure opposed to the poet or the writer, as someone who is also moving between languages and building bridges, creating perhaps, to stay with your image, a house for himself in two languages, which on the one hand gives him personally maybe some kind of security, but I think also sort of in the terms of the bigger picture can be a way of doing some repair work or some kind of therapy in the sense of using resources of one language to help heal the wounds in another language that shocks have caused. So I guess I'll stop it there and invite you to comment.
Yeah, certainly the translator is a very important character in the history of culture. Without him or her, it's not possible, this profound communication, this spiritual communication. I, as an adolescent, I wrote a lot, I read a lot, almost everything which I could put my hand on, and everything was in Romanian. So I read the great Russian literature in Romanian, French literature, and so on. Some years ago, I saw in a newspaper, in a magazine in the United States, where it appeared a new edition of Thomas Mann, and this article said that finally, we are very happy that his irony went through. This was decades after the first books appeared. What happened in between with the reader if he read without this irony? So this is a very complicated process in our time, even more so because the domination of the financial criteria are very hostile to real creativity and literature. So, but what was here mentioned about Pnin is beyond the humor important. He used to say that he read Shakespeare and he's much better in Russian than in English. I had some Polish friends in New York who tried to convince me that Hamlet is much better in Polish than in English. So we can smile or laugh about this. These are normal consequences of this complicated process of spreading culture into other spirituality. It's not only about the literal translation from one language to another, the sentences, the syntax, and all this. It is to transport the profound meaning and spirituality of a page into another language, another history, another culture. I had the strange luck in last years to be translated into Chinese, which, as you imagine, I knew very well. So I asked some friends, how is it? I don't understand anything. I look to this page as a draft, as a picture. And this very good friend of mine, she said, look, it's well translated. It was translated not from Romanian, of course, but from English, so it went to other two languages. But you should know that Chinese is very different. Even the colors are different. They are not the colors which we know in Europe. There are, I don't know how many, black and red and so on. So in order to select exactly the right word, you have to think a lot. So to make it more simple, if we can say, is that in our time, if you enter into this magic internet, you can have the translation. It's a literal, brutal, simplified translation if you want to see what is it about. But literature is not what is it about. It's never about information or only about information. It's beyond information. There is the real power of literature and of creativity. So how can we enter into possession of this other side, much more important, much more ambiguous than the simple information which we have in a book? A man and a woman, they are married. The woman betrays the man, or the man betrays the woman commits suicide. This is an information which we find in a newspaper. Literature is beyond this. So translation is as complicated as you know, but we have to profit as much as we can from it. As I told in my text, I came to the States without English, so I was deaf mute suddenly in a huge country with a very complicated, interesting, original culture. And what should I do? You go to refind your place, you go to a library. There you have all your old friends. All the authors are there, but in another language. So this mystery of discovering this other world goes, I think, to literature and to creativity and not only to the daily reality, as good or bad as it is. You are here and you are myself, so I'm very pleased to be again here. Since I was last year here, 2012, I became younger, much younger. I am more vital. It was an infusion of youth. So I hope that today it will be another magic transformation. But you are a spiritual enclave in Berlin, and a very important one, in my opinion. I liked very much last time the atmosphere, the questions, the dialogue here. But you are here in a city that became itself a much more open, much more cosmopolitan, worldly city. And you, in this group of foreign beauties, if I may say so, are a very special enclave. And where translation is essential, because you come with different languages, with different backgrounds, with different cultures, and suddenly you try to root yourself in this global language, which is English today. And this is an extraordinary premise for the globalization itself, for better or for worse. I was asked many times what I understand by globalization, because as you know, there are many enemies of globalization which consider that it destroys the real national identity and so on. I said always the same, the aspirin. I consider that the aspirin is the best symbol of globalization. You go wherever you go, this little pill is there. It's global. It's without ethnicity, without religion, without any belonging.
It's from Berlin.
I don't believe Bayer. I'm not saying Bayer, but it's from Berlin, yes. So it's a simple answer to a quite complicated issue.
Have you ever translated yourself?
Happily not. I never dare to do it. It's enough trouble and suffering when I read the other translation, so, yeah.
Thank you. My question is in a different realm, but it does connect to what you said previously about feeling younger since you were here earlier. And
it's not about our vicinity. I spoke in general.
Yes, yes, I know, of course. And it connects to the art and craft of writing, as you talk about it in the Exiled Language, because on the one hand you say that writing is a road to immaturity. And so the first part of the question is, how does this manifest in your writing? How does this manifest in your life, rather? So how does this process influence your life? And when you think about it in terms of your past and your own childhood, do you think that this could be a way of reconnecting with this lost childhood, in a way? And whether that connection and that path is something that you found very beneficial, not only in your writing but also in your life. And secondly, so this other side of writing and time is that you begin the essay by saying word. You say that the word was the beginning, and you end by saying that the word is also the end. So when David and I were talking about this, we immediately thought of religious references, and when we were wondering of, not even talking in terms of religion, but more in terms of belief and faith, is this something that keeps you going? Is that something that came through this essay to us, this hope, this faith? does it connect also to this immaturity, to writing as a road to immaturity, or what is the relationship for you, if any?
Yeah. I will try my best to shock you through simplicity, which is not easy. I do think that the word, the language, is the essence of our life, be it for a dentist, be it for a driver, be it more than anybody else for a writer who works in this realm. Now, you have to have a certain kind of, in order to keep this doing again and again. First of all, as I said, you enter into a library, you see how many books are already written. Some are quite wonderful. What to do more? So it's a way of discouraging this dream. But our great sculptor Ben Kush said at a certain point that when the writer is not more a child, he's dead. Because you need a certain candor to do it again and again. This is not the candor of the boy of 5 years old. It's another kind of candor. It's another kind of freshness, openness, if you want. Because you start again and you have in front of you a page, an empty page. You can do whatever you want there. It's the greatest freedom possible to do whatever you want from nothing. What is the end result? The end result is that you added something to society, to life, something, a product, not a natural one, an unnatural one. You added one to what was before, something which in the best cases is new or brings kind of novelty from an aesthetic point of view, from an artistic point of view. So this kind of vocation, profession, whatever you call it, I'm proud to say that it's the most crazy one. If you want, and many writers already said it, it's a devilish one. You have to start again and again to find in yourself the voice that tells something which is fresh, new, original, provocative, a kind of provocation, because without this it doesn't mean anything. And this is how I think about this. And we spoke here and in this text, and even the title of this meeting is Literature on Extreme Situation. Extreme situation we have a lot around us, in the past, in the history, all type of extreme situations. How do you deal in literature with extreme situations? Because if literature and creativity is indeed the greatest form of freedom, the greatest form of liberty, suddenly this extreme situation starts to be a limitation. You cannot do whatever you want with a story, let's say, about the Holocaust, where the little Jewish boy is a crook, and the German officer who is beaten him is an angel. It's original, but it doesn't have any truth in it, any authenticity. And the great danger for this type of extreme situation, usually a tragedy, is cliché. Is the cliché, which is at the start or at the end of every page, the big danger. You enter into the cliché, into something which is already known. The Romanian audience said, I should speak louder. I'm not sure about this.
Can you hear in the back?
Yeah, they can, of course. No. Yes or not?
No.
Not.
We still have a few seats in the front.
Come here and sit on the floor.
On the back.
You will be close to me. So this is what I'm saying about the big danger transporting into literature an extreme situation and making it or being influenced by a cliché. Any tragedy which is acknowledged publicly, debated, and ends up in a kind of cliché. If you say today Holocaust, you have a certain image of horror. If you say Gulag, if you say this wonderful Islamic fanaticism, you already have an image about the brutality, about the horror, about the blood, about the cruelty. You as a writer have to see something more ambiguous, more important, more provocative, which means to look again and again to the individual. Only there do we find complexity in whatever situation, whatever simplified and radical situation, in the individual, in the differences between us, between our sensitivity and our formation and our past and our education. There appears a lot of notes which makes the story and the tragedy authentic and interesting. I hope I used enough clichés so that you understood everything.
Yes. More than I asked for, so I'm happy I inspired a flow of thought that I think was very beautiful to hear. And on that note, we would like to open the floor to questions from the audience on anything literature and extreme situations, writing, the excerpts that we have read.
Who are you?
I'm Ryan. Nice to meet you. You were talking about authenticity in writing, and I wanted to ask about your thoughts on authenticity in writing as a writer in exile. On one hand, if you write in your native language, the language which is your home and the most authentic for you, you're immediately removing yourself from the culture in which you're situated. And if you're writing in a new language, in a second language, you're removing yourself from your own authenticity of self. And I wanted to hear your thoughts on that.
I don't think it's necessarily such a drastic move. If you move from your culture to the new culture, you totally forgot your culture, or vice versa. They are, after some years, interferences. You live in a certain place, surrounded by a language, about a culture, about habits, which are probably many of them foreign to you. And you come with your habits, with your biography, with your memory, with your cultural memory. Yet after a while, the process is complicated and complex because it's such a drastic situation. It's a very drastic dispossession of your place, of your language, of your past, of everything. This dispossession can mean sometimes a vague or timid rebirth in a new place. Not a total one, it depends very much on the age when you move. In my case, as I said, it was an age where you don't make more such very drastic situations. Nabokov had learned English and French and German in his family before he learned Russian. So this great case, which I mentioned all the time, that he's the greatest polyglot, is true because he had an extraordinary gift for languages, but his start was different from a common start. So I think we don't have to make this extreme experience, which is exile, and certainly it is extreme, as a totally dark and devilish happening. Everything which is human is, in my opinion, imperfect. Even unhappiness is imperfect. There are strange places that open up. There are moments of curiosity and intensity in the new place. What you are forced to is usually you are forced to reconsider your thinking, your cliches, your tradition, and confront it with the unknown. This is one of the most difficult and most rich experiences. If you live in your home and homeland from birth to death, can also be very interesting, but it's not so challenging as you have to move from that place to another one where you meet the unknown people, unknown ideas, an unknown civilization, which is very often very challenging, if not overwhelming. So, to come to America, in my case, was a very, very very big shock. It was another country, another dimension of human experience, another variety of people, and another rhythm of life. So, but if you are not very religious, we should think that we have one life. And if we have one, that's what we have. We should make the best from it.
Yeah, I can.
Tougher questions.
I'm Valère.
Valère? Was that Francais or Romain?
Romain.
Oh, c'est bien.
When did you realize that you've become a hooligan?
I was helped in this. It was not only my realization and my performance. The environment, the cultural environment in Romania, in a certain period, became heavily racist and nationalistic. And I was even called so, but even beyond the word, it was a way of designing the foreigner, the guy who doesn't belong to the nation, to the country, to its history, and so on. In Romanian and in Romania, this word in the cultural history has a special meaning and a special history. In the 30s, when the nationalist movement became stronger, not totally powerful, but still stronger to normal elections. I mean, the Iron Guard won a lot of votes in the 30s. They and their publications were very proud to identify themselves as hooligans. That meant anti-bourgeois. You know, you were a flamboyant fighter for the big future of the nature, of the nation, but your main credentials, your main vision was very morbid. They praised death as the greatest fulfillment of life, also martyrdom, sacrifice, so on. It was a certain dispute in the Romanian cultural scene in the late 30s, in which a Jewish Romanian writer, Mihai Sebastian, published a book which was called For 2000 Years, in which he presented in a fictional way the impossibility of the Jewish destiny, which meant that no solution can solve this unsolvable problem. And the solutions were religion, Zionism, which meant going back to the old country, communism, which meant we are all equal and suddenly we don't have any Jewish problem more, and each and assimilation. Assimilation in the Romanian culture so that you don't see more a difference. At that time, it appeared also a novel by his good friend Mircea Eliade, which was called The Hooligans, where he presented this right-wing militants, which I already described. Sebastian was very much attacked for this novel by the Jewish press, by the anti-Semitic press, by the entire press. And then he published a little essay, brilliant in my opinion, which was called How I Became a Hooligan. And he explains that he identifies himself as a hooligan, not as this hooligan member of a great community of believers, but as a solitary man. And he says at that time, I am not a partisan, I am a solitary man, but in this solitary man, I believe a lot. So this was the polemic which, after 60 years, 80 years, it won a special meaning in our time. As you know, the confrontation between the totalitarian ideology today, whatever form it takes, and it takes, as you know, today mainly a religious form, and the imperfect democracy, because this is how it is, and this is how it should be. It's never pure, it's never perfect. It's a way of finding the mood to collaborate between people who have different voices, different visions. So, who will win, you will know. I will be far away.
Any other questions?
Andy?
Yeah.
My name is Andy.
I'm sure you are also from Romania.
The country that has translated your work.
problem.
Well, actually, something I want to talk about is to, the question I want to ask is actually related to language, because the Chinese language is really corrupted, I would argue, after the Communist Party take place. It's even kind of dead, because it's just filled with all kind of ideology and propaganda. It's only became more alive after like Mao died and we had a reform and open policy. And to be honest, I wasn't aware of its corruptness, you know, or I wasn't aware of how the Chinese language was so much different from its ancient counterpart until I started to read currently my favorite Chinese writer who died 3 years ago, but he is actually also a writer in exile. He went to America also after he was like tortured in the entire Cultural Revolution period. So I am really grateful towards him.
So was his language different, more fresh,
more fresh,
more interesting?
Yes.
With less cliches, with less dogma?
There are a lot of things that he says, just like, I can only read from him, and no one else write things like that. And probably the best thing about him is that I see no party language in him. Everything I see is either himself or from the ancient texts, like Taoism, Confucianism, or all the poets. Like, he's really great. So
Is he published in China?
Yes.
Is he praised?
He's very unheard of.
Can you repeat the name, Andy?
Yeah.
Muxin, Muxin.
Muxin.
Muxin. That's his pen name, of course. And what I want to ask is, do you find yourself to be in a similar position? Because you're also coming from a post-communism country or post-totalitarian society. Do you find your role or responsibility is to also kind of like bring the dead language to be alive again?
Yeah, the dead language, which was called in that time in communist Romania or in perhaps in China too, the wooden language. Destroyed a lot of writers. I modestly say that it was not my case. I defended myself as much as I could from this poison, from this official language. And I was not the only one. Romania, and you can find discussing this with your colleague Valer, is not China and not Germany, which are much more pure, I would say, in their belief. Romania is a Balkanic country with a lot of charm and a lot of ambiguity, and generally speaking, the reality is not on the table, but under the table. So even in this complication with a language, there were not one or two, there were several, and I would say quite many writers who escaped this very wooden, rigid, stupid type of official language. This is not a language for literature. This was a language for propaganda, and the political language, generally speaking, even in a free society, is a simplification, because this is political thinking. Literature cannot afford this luxury to simplify. Literature tries to nuance, to introduce ambiguities, complications, questions, doubts, and so on. This is not for political language. This is very different. But the political language, which was very dogmatic, of course, was domineering in that time and place because it was the official language, and it was the official language of a system which was a totalitarian system, who wanted to possess everything. And generally speaking, at least in that period, the system, the state, owned us, owned all of us. It was a heavy censor. Private property was mainly not allowed. After decades, it started to be allowed. So you lose all these possibilities of choice. You have to work. You have to have a salary. You have to live. Who gives you a place for work? The party. So the party becomes a kind of god. There were not competition. It was a competition between the human defects, let's say, the human shortcomings, and a heavy competition. But otherwise, officially, you had very few solutions. The solutions were and still are there, under the table. Friendship, connections, humor, corruption, nepotism. And I had the occasion to see, and not in one case, the good effect of corruption. I can tell you that in the concentration camp, corruption worked positively because it was possible to corrupt, I'm sorry to say it for Valer, who is here, it was not so difficult to corrupt a Romanian officer, but it was quite impossible to corrupt a German officer. So, corruption had a good effect, saved lives, gave a kind of temporary hope. I just read before I left New York a very interesting book by a Swedish writer who describes his family coming back from Auschwitz and starting a new life in Sweden. And at a certain point, he discusses the famous case, which you find in Hannah Arendt's book, about the leader of the you see, I'm not more young even here.
Jewish councils?
The Judenrat.
What?
The Jewish councils?
Yeah, the Judenrat, which was a kind of committee of Jews, intermediary between the Jewish community and the German authorities in the camps. And in this case, they had to deliver from time to time Jews to be sent to Auschwitz and killed. This kind of Judenrat is very much and heavily and rightly partially criticized by Hannah Arendt as a sign of cowardice and betrayal and so on. In this book, I found something extremely interesting, and this is again the role of a writer and not of a political thinker. He said, I don't claim the moral authority to condemn these people for their compromise. Because they were in a situation without solution and they did whatever they could better. And he gives there the speech of this Mr. Rumkowski, very famous guy in the Judenrat, when he comes before the Jewish community to explain what he did yesterday in the discussion with the Germans. And the discussion was, they have to send all the kids up to 9 years old to be killed. He tried to obtain an extension. It should be until 10 years old, not 9 years old. The Germans didn't agree. He delivered. And this speech is, I must tell you, extraordinary. Why did he do it? He committed suicide in the end. But this is another story. They did it hoping to win time. And maybe, maybe, it will start to be milder. I can tell you that in my situation as a child, I was 5 years old when I was deported, and I was not a Jew. I didn't know what Jewish means. I was a child. So suddenly I was in a train going to the end of the earth without knowing why. But I can tell you that the situation in the camps was not the same during the entire period. The first, the most difficult period was the first 2 years. Then it was a battle of Stalingrad. The Romanians are extremely smart. This you should not forget, Valer. And they understood that it's not so clear that the Germans will win. They were allied with Nazi Germany, but they started to doubt it. And they knew that if the Germans will not win and Germany will be defeated, this reactionary government in Romania will be very heavily judged. And indeed, the leader, the Marshal Antonescu, was killed by a tribunal after the war. And the policy in the camp changed. It didn't become wonderful, but it was possible to work a bit and to receive more than we received in the first year, which was one bread for four people. So that you understand this mechanism, what you do in this type of situation. The religious people still had a support, their friend in heaven. But we other crazy non-believers or illiterate, if you want, we didn't know to whom to speak. So these are these type of extreme situations. There were many during the Nazi time, there were many during the communist terror, and there are today, as you read in the papers, many in this new Islamic fanaticism, where they want that all the infidels be killed. That means all of us. And then they will be happy not only with the 70 virgins in heaven, but they will be the owners of the world. This is the extreme crazy situation, which again, I would say it again and again because it's related to this text of mine, The Monuments of Shame, they are human situations. These are created by humans, not by devil. They are created by humans, they are subverted by humans, they are stopped by humans, but it's an entire human history in all these atrocities. Yeah, sorry. You are also not from Romania.
My name sometimes.
I see.
I don't know whether you would like to say anything about it, but I'll ask anyway. You mentioned irony, reference to Thomas Mann. You mentioned sort of what's beneath the table and how that works in Balkanic societies, as I think you called them. I'm interested in your thoughts about the relationship between working as someone who writes essays and someone who writes fiction and someone who writes fiction that is sometimes autobiographical writings that are fictional. The easy way out would be the Kafka quotation that we heard earlier about living only and not being real. You said something very similar just on the other side of the street. I'm just interested in how you see, one way of putting it is, how many of your essays, or which of your essays do you think are essays in the sense, if any, are essays in the sense of you speaking as someone who you're not sure that it is yourself? And how many are not essays in that more radical sense of trying something out, perhaps even trying out a role, but where at least in the moment you think there's little distance between you as a writer and you as whatever, as a person like any other?
I don't know what you mean by any other.
No, I don't know what I mean by that either.
Okay.
So leave that aside.
So we have the same language. Look, the easiest way out is usually with a joke. So I will try one, because they said when you don't have any solution, that's the solution. A very famous Spanish movie director said that anything which is not autobiographical is plagiarism. I don't know if he's right, but the joke is good. So I take this joke going farther. I think that mainly, even if you don't deal with the material which is in your memory and in your biography, trying to make it literature, I have to say that it's never exactly the same as it was in reality. Because in the moment you start to write, the writing itself takes you away from the perfect facts of what you lived, because you need there some other components which you put in. But when I came to the States, it was also a cultural shock. I didn't have my language. I was I don't know where. So in the first years, I wrote mainly essays. Because for better or for worse, the essay has a logical structure. You start from here and go there, more or less. In my case, probably less. But let's accept it. You demonstrate something. You deal with a certain subject. In literature, this is death, if it's logical. It shouldn't be logical. Because life is not logical at all, for better or for worse, as you know. So, and I came with great difficulty back to fiction, and the fiction was also autobiographical. I started to have some American friends. And usually they ask me to tell them about my life. And usually at the end they say, oh, wonderful story. You should write this. Norman, it's a great story. I didn't. I couldn't. But I went back to my past to find here and there some fragments which I was interested in, and I was advised, of course, to write about America. And today, after so many years, I regret that I didn't do it. Because at that point I had a fresh perception of the country. Almost everything seemed to me crazy, and this would have been interesting. Now, after so many years, everything which seemed to me crazy, it's not more so crazy. And as I told you in the car, in the first year at Bard, I failed half of the class. Failure, F. Sorry, you don't know anything. And then I woke up. Norman, what do you want to do? You want to change the educational system in this big country? Not to say that there is considered also a kind of hostility. It's not that you applied only pedagogical criteria and you gave this guy an F. It's F, it's as if you have something against the person. It's very personal, although the most banal saying in America is, it's nothing personal. They fire you from your job and you receive a letter, it's not personal, Norman. What is it? It's very personal. It's extremely personal. So don't take it as something personal. We were in a certain situation, we have to fire some people, you know how it is. That's it. And being a pragmatic country by structure, which means a very profound and big way of simplifying life in order to make it workable. This is American approach, again, for better or for worse. There are wonderful things there, there are terrible things there. That's how it should be. But for a newcomer, an adolescent of 52, it was a shock. So I hope I didn't answer your question.
Can I?
You can everything because you are a professor.
No, but we have students.
It's okay.
And the follow up would be, I guess what's interesting to me is you probably had some sense, at least initially, when you started giving more grades that weren't F, that somehow your, whatever you want to call it, you're real, you're more authentic, you're more honest, whatever, self,
yes,
would give the Fs.
Yes.
So at one, and this is where I think the sort of irony and play with personas and difference between what is fiction or what is just a role that you're playing, for instance, in arguing something that you don't necessarily believe or not sure about how,
yeah,
you believe,
yeah,
right? How those things shade into each other, because and how that connects with perhaps certain aspects of being in exile, right? Where perhaps at a certain point that inauthentic, dishonest American new self of yours becomes more something that you become, that is you. And the old strict Romanian self, I know these are ludicrous simplifications, but I'm
no, it was not only Romanian, it was also Habsburg.
Habsburg, right?
Because I come from Bukovina, I can tell you in our high school there were two entrances. One for teachers, the other for students.
Good idea.
Well, when I came to America and we have the first break with my first class, and the students came to me to ask me different questions, they started, Norman, what do you think about this? Norman? I am Norman? In my high school, the professor, which was this typical Habsburg, Bukovinian, very strict, when the teacher, the mathematics teacher, entered in the class, I was a good student, but this didn't help. We were all like little animals, scared to death. He opens the catalog, and then we wait for the killing moment. Norman Manea, go to the table. You go to the table, and after 1 minute, what?
Blackboard.
Tafel.
Yes. And yes, tabla. It is a blackboard. And after 5 minutes, you hear, you are a total idiot. Tell your mother to come on tomorrow to the school. This was the atmosphere of total terror. This was the school, a very serious school, by the way. I learned a lot of things there, but coming to this free atmosphere where the student is your Norman and you are his Norman, suddenly you don't know how to behave. Now, time passed. I can tell you today that I like it. I liked it much more because it doesn't matter. Not this matters. It matters the real dialogue. He can say, you know, a man and whatever. So I liked in the end this simplicity of relationship. And today I like it. I'm sorry to tell you because I know you are a professor. Yes, so yes, this is a story. You come with your baggage, with your luggage, and you try to understand a bit the new place, the new visions, the new people, and then you change. I changed, but a bit. I'm still the old crazy guy, as you can see. Yeah, Peter.
My name is Akisha.
How? How is it?
Akasia.
Mm-hmm.
Akasia.
Where are you from?
I'm from America, but I was named
America.
Up.
Our America.
Named
what
up.
A pleasure. Wonderful.
So I have a question regarding languages in particular. I've noticed that many people have different ideas of when you are proficient in a language. For example, some people think that you have to be able to dream in that language.
If you have a lover which is from another place, you will dream in another language. If not, I am not sure about this. Go on, sorry.
I was wondering first what perhaps your signifiers are of when you feel comfortable with the language. And then further from that, I've noticed that when I'm speaking in German versus in English, I express myself very differently. A lot of that is because my vocabulary is not as good.
Sure.
But I've noticed that perhaps we have at least different ways of exploring our personalities when we speak in different languages. And I was wondering if you find the same phenomenon of exploring or expressing different facets of your personality depending on what language you're speaking.
Absolutely. You are perfectly right. It is so. It is another way of putting to work your sensitivity in another frame, in another vocabulary, with other rules. As you know, German has a verb in the end. So you wait for 2 hours the sentence to end, and in the end you have the verb and you understand what the action is. This doesn't happen in English or in other languages. This changes also in a way the way you have to express what you feel. And it's an important change, because if you speak even with the best translators, the most professional translators in the world, you will hear that however good they are, let's say perfectly bilingual, in both languages the same, still there are things which cannot be transported, which are specifically for that language. And this means, as we know already, for that feeling, for that culture, for that history, for that mentality. It is something which was created. The language is not something static, as you know. It's something which evolved in decades, and it, language has its own history in every place. And here are the differences. But if you are mobile enough and open enough, you can, I think, assimilate. And I will again dare to give my own example. I, as a kid, I heard many languages. My only real language, should it call it maybe internal language, of course, is Romanian. But I learned. The second class I did in Russian, then I did in Romanian, then I learned French and Hebrew. And so I had several languages, which I didn't use. Especially, I will give this example with Hebrew. Hebrew is not a language which I use. I don't have a Hebrew mistress, so I cannot use it. And this was when I was 13 years old. Now, as I said already, I am 14. So a lot of time passed. Still, I discover. And I learned Hebrew for 1 year. That was all. A wonderful teacher, but 1 year. I discover now, when I have in front of me a Hebrew paper, a newspaper, and I don't know if, is it here somebody who knows Hebrew?
Not tonight. Oh yeah.
Many. So I learned Hebrew without these signs under the letters. You know what I mean. What? So, because after you know well the language, you understand without having these signs what the word is. As a kid, I learned it in a very traditional way, without these signs. Now, when I take a paper from Israel, let's say, it's without these signs.
So you learn it with the signs?
Sure.
It's not
with I learned with the signs. After such a long time, now if I look, the words are without the signs. And yet, I guess, quite often, the word and the meaning. I was a kid. Meantime, as you understood, I was very adventurous. I moved from one place to another, and so on. And a lot of things happened. Yet, in the mind of the child there, still stayed something. This is to answer you. You are not more a child, you are a perfect, mature woman of 38 or 39, as I understand, but it can happen even to you. I'm joking. Don't be upset. Yeah. Yes, please.
Hi, my name is Anna.
Anna from where?
From the United States.
Again, yeah.
So I'm sort of thinking about what you called that first pedagogical moment of having to speak in a language that isn't your own or having to speak in a world that doesn't feel your own, and its relationship to that like uncanniness of literature or what is an excess of mere information. I guess I'm wondering if you could say more about the experience of the writer in exile, who is in many ways like in excess of the nation or makes it historically reprehensible in certain ways. Like what that experience means for pedagogy and that progression into like a different childhood, which is like a different substance of life in some ways. And like in terms of thinking about history, I guess like also thinking of like what Adorno writes about education after Auschwitz and what you call those monuments of shame. Yeah.
I'm sorry to say you have to limit yourself.
Okay.
In order that I can limit myself. there are too many subjects, they are very interesting all, but I don't know how to bring them all together. So select one which is the most unpleasant, and I'm ready to do it.
Yeah, I think the most unpleasant might be...
you take me seriously. I told you that I joke all the time, and you still take me seriously. Okay.
That was good advice.
I don't know. What made you cringe? I guess the pedagogical moment of like being forced to speak in a language that doesn't feel your own, and how like that feeling of like being in excess of a nation relates to like a personal pedagogy, because you say that the like individual is the most important for like bringing life into a work. So I don't know if I'm just like being totally circular again.
Probably yes. Look, this first moment when you have to express yourself and you are not able because you don't have the means, you are in a foreign language, you know in your mind, because your mind still works with the old language, with your old language, what you want to say, but you don't have the means. It's a very frustrating moment. And in some cases, quite humiliating, especially when you are not more a child. So you come in front of an audience, and I had these experiences at the beginning, even in the States. I tried, of course, first to simplify what I want to say, in order not to have to use two nuances, two complicated vocabulary. But it's very frustrating. In the same time, we know, and we should not forget, that there are hundreds of languages on this planet. We cannot know all the languages. You have the big advantage that you know the most important language of today, where, with which you can deal everywhere, and you probably had this already, this experience. English became the language of the planet, for better or for worse. People of deeply rooted English in their life deplore this popular, vulgar language of all the people, because unavoidably it starts to be degraded. It's not the language of the great classic writers. It became a very popular language, and it is used as such. So I think you should stay proud in your English and deal with it whatever you can. It will be fine. Yes, please. Your name is?
Marga.
Also Romanian?
South Africa.
Yes.
So you mentioned that there are things that cannot be transported between languages. So in your works, when you read the translated versions of them, do you find that there is an absence or something lacking in the way that it's been translated? Or do you even maybe find that there are greater layers of
in order to compare, you have to know the initial text in whatever language it is. For instance, if I have to confront a text which I know in the Romanian language and I have to read it in English, I know what to compare. But if the text is translated from, I don't know what kind of dialect is in South Africa, and there are probably many, I cannot compare, and I take the translation as fact, as something, this is the text. Then you come from South Africa and tell me, no, this text has a lot of errors. It's totally faked. But I didn't know this.
Okay.
and I don't have how to know it. You can know it because you can compare. If I don't have the elements to compare, I am disarmed.
But I hope I'm trying to get at the same thing. But don't you, as someone, for instance, whose French is quite good, whose English is quite good, whose German is quite good, when you're reading your own, if you're reading your own texts in English, and some of those translators are not idiots, right? What would you then say in response to Margaret's question?
But
then you do have some basis of comparison.
Yes. And there are some portions, some fragments, which sound different and from the initial language, because the good translator doesn't follow literally the text. He tries to express the meaning of the text. Then he has to cut here, to change a bit there, in order to gain exactly the meaning of what you wanted to say in Romanian, which is, by the way, a very nuanced and complicated language. It has the Latin roots, but it has additions from many other languages. And to give you own comparison, it is quite close to Italian. And we can understand, without learning Italian, something in Italian. They cannot understand Romanian, because it's a mixture with Slavic words, with Greek, Turkish words. The Latin is the old one. So it's not easy. It's a complicated language, and therefore we love it, because it's complicated.
My name is Simone.
Simone, vous êtes français?
No, I'm Dutch.
Dutch?
Yeah.
Even better. So.
So you said that you regretted not writing about the United States when your perception was still fresh.
Yes.
And I was wondering if you could elaborate some more on this, because, say, if you stay longer in a place, your perception might not be fresh anymore, but it might become more profound and more layered, and you might reach some sort of deeper understanding of a country, as opposed to a fresh perception. But I was wondering what you think would be the best moment to write about a place to get more to the core, because perhaps if you have a fresh perception, this is more authentic, more of an authentic way of seeing things. And perhaps if you stay longer and your understanding becomes more profound, you might lose knowledge.
Yes, you lose this freshness with time, because all the for instance, we spoke a bit about clichés. At the start, the cliché is scandalous, and it's a provocation. After a while, it's not more. You use it in the daily language, you are used to it, and it's not more such a surprise. How it's better, it's difficult to say. I regret that because my first period in the state was very tense, and I didn't have the patience to write down at least some, let's say, linguistic strange happenings on the street, at the college, and so on. I didn't. Because this would have been interesting. To read it now, after 20 years, to see how candid I was, or naive, or childish, or open, or pure, whatever you want to call it, and to compare it with what I know now. I didn't do this. So now I have the good luck, I think, that my English is still very imperfect. So the experience is not finished. And I will try to write down here and there some crazy expressions and some crazy, which are in every language. And you discover there the ingenuity, the strangeness of a sentence, of some words, of some combination of words. I stay sometimes with my young wife, my first wife, which we are married for some 70 years. And suddenly speaking, because we speak in Romanian, we discover an extraordinary expression without a real logical meaning, but wonderful expression, invention of language, of joke, and suddenly we say, look how wonderful it sounds. We never, when we were there, didn't think about this, because it was in the routine. It was in the daily exercise of speaking, of communication, and you didn't see it, you didn't pay attention to it. Suddenly, being out of the place, forgetting some things already, this comes back with a fresh, with a very fresh sound and sometimes meaning. Yes.
I suggest you take your question since you're running out of time, and if there's another one really, really burning question, we can take this one,
yes.
And then we should take the discussion outside with a glass of wine, more relaxed.
Yes.
Space.
First you, sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Professor Norman.
Professor.
Professor Norman. I read your text about Saul Steinberg.
Yes.
And as you mentioned, that you always think of others as taxi drivers, so also you don't, as a writer, only think of writers. I try to make up a comparison of him as a draftsman and illustrator to you as a writer coming into the same country, though, which is America.
Yes.
And I wonder about many ways of your saying tonight how hard it is, this change, but actually isn't it almost harder for anybody else? I mean, if you're a Romanian horse trader and you have to go into exile and you end up on East 11th Street in Manhattan because there are a few Romanians there and you cannot speak Romanian in your taxi. Now, then, 10 other people in between, vocations in between, and then you come to Saul Steinberg, who is kind of next to you because he was also an acknowledged artist, but he's a draftsman. And you have this little episode when he calls you, and he gives you all those street names, in, right?
Yes.
Those inner city, old cities, crazy street names, and you sort of well translations of the Romanian street names are given in the German translation, and I mean they're just very imaginative. And why does he do that? Because he suffers that it's not there anymore. For him, it's, as you point out, it's actually smells.
Yes.
And he misses that.
Yes.
And he's, in a way, I think in your portrait he's desperate, but you're not. At least you don't seem to be, to me, desperate at all. And I mean, isn't it, if you, now this, you ask the tough questions, right? I mean, isn't it almost the other way around, that if you're an established writer in your own language and you come to a country, in a way too late, but early enough that your literature that's already been written can be translated, I mean, then you have this huge national treasure which he can preserve and elaborate, and other people are even interested in getting that into their own languages, which actually happened to you. So, you know, I'm not turning your success against you, but Why
I'm not?
I'm a fiction writer in this
Why
room,
not?
For example. I'm a fiction writer in this room. Okay, I will. I'm a fiction writer in this room, and I'm not a translator. I suffer a lot from that, but I'm not in exile. Okay? So, I mean, isn't it somehow also a great, great task compared to all the others? I mean, the taxi drivers who really lose their language and everything?
I'm sorry to say that I totally agree with you. You are right. I don't have. I never look down to the taxi driver, or to the guy who has his luggage of linguistical language and can or cannot manipulate it. In the writer's case, I saw, and here you should tolerate me, because we have to give us own a bit of importance when nobody else gives us. So then I want to dramatize a bit the situation, which I think still was dramatic enough. Look, I said it, maybe here even, I did not want to leave Romania. And I did not want to go to America at all, because I felt that I am a too strange beast there. The country is different, it's too vital for me, it's too pragmatic for me, it's too big for me, and so on. But this is how it happened, and I must say now that I was lucky. I ended up in a country of exiles. Everybody came from some place, so I was, and I said this, that the best thing which I learned is to give up on my importance. I understood that I'm not most so important. My suffering is not the greatest in the world. The guy who comes from Ghana or I don't know from where maybe suffered more. So this comparison was not only educational, but it was a way of stimulating my thinking about myself and the place. So I do agree with you about everything which you said. In the same time, we cannot ignore this addition, this strange addition to the strangeness of the writer everywhere. It is a plus. It is a plus for better or for worse. I say it and I emphasize again that it's for better or for worse. It's for both. After 20 years of the exile and even before, I understood also the advantages of it. And I even wrote an essay some years after I left Romania that speaking about my colleagues which remained in Romania. And I said, as much as I suffer with this change and this dispossession, they have also their own many, many problems. And nobody knows about them. At least about me, I was the devil promoted me. He liked me. Yeah, I agree with you. I agree with you. Valer.
The question was about that Romanian expression.
What?
My question was about that Romanian expression you are talking about. What's the expression?
I don't know what you mean.
You were talking before about the discussion between you and your ex-wife.
Mm.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. I will give you one example, because it's only one word and it's easier. Chica.
How?
Chica.
Chica.
How do you translate chica?
Suddenly discovered how a funny word,
yeah.
How a humorous kind of playing word, and yeah. But speaking, I want to say a few words about Saul Steinberg. You read the text and you know how odd and interesting was my relationship with him. because at the beginning when he heard I'm a Romanian, he didn't want to speak with me. What? What did I do wrong? He had so bad memories that he considered all the Romanians crooks and liars and so. Anyway, we became friends. This is how life is. And as I tell in the text, he used to call me in the morning with a dictionary on his lip, asking me, tell me, Mama Liga, from where does come this word? Is it Turkish? What do you think?
Kiftia.
Is it Turkish? I said, yes, Kiftia, I think it's Turkish, because we have here a Turkish restaurant in the neighborhood, and we see there in the menu the word Kiftia. So, yeah. And many other things. This is Italian, this is German, this is... He was fascinated by the words, and he told me he left Romania when he was 19. Was a student in the first year at the university and wanted to study languages and wanted to become a writer. Then he went to Italy and studied architecture. And he said, look, I lost it. I understood. Then I started to write literature through pictures, through images. This is my way of replacing literature. He was a very interesting and funny man, very difficult, but huge talent. I compared him to an important Romanian poet, Tudor Aghezi, because they had the same bitterness, you know. This guy, Aghezi, who lived a long life in his latest age, met with some young writers at a Romanian magazine, and they asked him, Master, in Romanian literature, poets die young. You know this. They drunk, they have a lot of love affairs, they are exhausted, they are depressed. How did you do that? You reach this age? And he stayed a second and said, boy, bitterness. Bitterness. This was the recipe. I was bitter from the start to the end. This is how I reached this age.
But isn't it surprising that Steinberg squeezed all this bitterness from his art? I mean,
absolutely.
His art doesn't look bitter at all.
No, it's humorous. It has
humor.
A humor. It has its, in a way, my article about him was even called Is He a Dadaist or so? Because in a way he can be put in this, because the Dada movement had some Romanian roots, as you probably know. And humor, this bitter humor in Romania is very, very usual and very good. He transported in his art, as Aghezi did, as his poet too did, because therefore they are artists, therefore they are writers. This is what they are doing with their inner self, bitter or not bitter. Yeah, now I understand we dance.
At least we eat. Thank you.